A value stock has a low price relative to some fundamental metric like book value or earnings. The value premium is the excess return that value stocks are expected to earn over the market. This excess return has historically been and is expected to continue to be positive. In other words, value stocks have higher expected returns than the market. The outperformance of value stocks was first documented in a 1985 paper by Barr Rosenberg, Kenneth Reed, and Ronald Landstein with the provocative title Persuasive Evidence of Market Inefficiency. They had observed that low-priced stocks had persistently higher risk-adjusted returns than they should in an efficient market. I'm Ben Felix, Portfolio Manager at PWL Capital. In this episode of Common Sense Investing, I'm going to tell you all that you need to know about the value premium. 7 years after the 1985 paper by Rosenberg, Reed, and Landstein, Eugene Fama and Kenneth French came out with a paper that would forever change the study of asset pricing, the cross-section of expected stock returns. Fama and French's 1992 paper took the empirical observations of small cap and value stocks delivering higher returns than their level of riskiness relative to the market would predict, and theorized that small cap and value stocks were exposed to independent systematic risks, separate from the risk of the market. They went on to build their now famous Fama-French three-factor model for asset pricing, which includes the independent risks of the market, small stocks, and value stocks. In 1992, Fama and French examined the 28-year data set from July 1963 to June 1991 for U.S. stocks. Over this time period, there was a large and statistically significant value premium, with value stocks beating the market by 4.9% per year on average. That's a huge difference. In the year 2000, Fama and French used previously unavailable data to examine the value premium from July 1926 to June 1963. U.S. value stocks beat the U.S. market by a smaller but still meaningful 2.39% per year on average over this time period. This should be compelling. Value stocks had historically offered an independent source of risk, which has diversification benefits in a portfolio, and they had offered a risk premium in excess of the market. The U.S. value premium is well documented for the full period leading up to Fama and French's 1992 paper. But it is also well documented that anomalies in the financial markets tend to disappear or decline once they have been published. This is an important point, and it goes to the core of financial theory. An observation like value stocks beating the market historically is not helpful in isolation. The observation becomes helpful when there is a strong theoretical explanation for it. The combination of empirical observations and theory allows us to build predictions about how things might be expected to behave in the future. For example, if stocks that start with the letter A outperform the market for a given 28-year period, there is no logical reason to believe that the same would be true for the next 28-year period. If, as Fama and French proposed, value stocks have higher expected returns because they are riskier, we would not expect the value premium to disappear post-publication. Economic theory predicts that riskier investments should demand higher expected returns. There is also a theoretical explanation for the existence of the value premium from behavioral economics. Both the risk-based and behavioral explanations for the value premium have strong empirical support. From the risk perspective, companies with lower prices tend to be under distress, have high financial leverage, and face substantial uncertainty in future earnings, as documented by Neifu Chen and Feng Zhang in their 1998 paper, Risk and Return of Value Stocks. And they tend to be much riskier than growth stocks in bad economic times, and only slightly less risky in good economic times, as documented by Liu Zhang in his 2005 paper, The Value Premium. These are real economic reasons for investors to demand higher expected returns for taking on more risk. On the behavioral side, in their 2012 paper, Identifying Expectation Errors in Value/Glamour Strategies, a Fundamental Analysis Approach, Joseph Piotrowski and Eric So observed systematic pricing errors causing value stocks to be underpriced and growth stocks to be overpriced. For example, investors may be too optimistic about the future growth prospects of a glamorous firm like Apple or Tesla, irrationally bidding up their prices and reducing their expected returns, while neglecting value stocks, increasing their expected returns. Other biases like confirmation bias, familiarity, anchoring, and loss aversion could also explain the persistent mispricing of value stocks. On the surface, it might seem like a behavior-based value premium would go away post-publication, because investors would be expected to smarten up once they realize their behavioral errors. but behavioral biases do tend to be persistent even when we know about them. There are also limits to arbitrage that can make it really hard for even the most disciplined, rational investors to take advantage of mispricings caused by behavioral biases. Think about the example of a pension investment officer choosing between two funds. One fund is expected to match the market's return and never underperform, while the other fund, maybe a value fund, is expected to beat the market by 1% per year on average, but it might have 5 or even 10-year periods where it underperforms the market. The pension investment officer likes her job and wants to keep the pensioners happy, so she is willing to give up the higher expected returns of the value fund to avoid the potential pain of underperformance. This agency issue causes a limit to arbitrage that will allow the mispricing of value stocks to persist. So far, we have talked about historical data for the value premium up to 1991, and the theory behind why we expect to see a positive value premium in the future. But there's been a big problem since 1991. The US value premium has been much weaker than it was in the past. For the period from July 1991 to June 2019, the value premium was an economically modest 1.17% per year on average, and it was not statistically different from zero. Fama and French came out with a new paper in January 2020, simply titled The Value Premium, where they ask, based on the weak post-publication data, whether we can confidently conclude that the US value premium declined or even disappeared following their 1992 paper. They found that the high volatility of monthly value premiums precludes us from drawing any conclusions about a change in the expected value premium based on this time period. Not being able to reject the hypothesis that out-of-sample expected premiums are the same as in-sample expected premiums sounds really nice, but the last few years, even the last decade, have been a bloodbath for US value investors. For the 3 years ending December 2019, value stocks trailed the market by 6.88% per year on average. If that's not pain, I don't know what is. For the decade ending December 2019, value stocks trailed the market by 2.24% per year on average. As painful as the recent history may have been for any committed value investor, periods like this should not be unexpected. In their 2018 paper, Volatility Lessons, Fama and French used Bootstrap to simulate 100,000 time periods of varying length to estimate the probability of the value premium being positive over a given time period. They found that over a 23-year period, there was a 23% chance of a negative premium. For a 10-year period, they found a 9% chance of a negative premium. We also have to remember that while the value premium can trail the market for long periods of time, the market can similarly trail treasury bills for a long period of time. And here's the kicker. Historically, there have been more 10-year periods where the US market delivered a negative premium than there have been 10-year periods where US value delivered a negative premium. And guess what? During some of those periods where US market delivered a negative premium, US value delivered a positive premium. If that's not a diversification benefit, I don't know what is. This discussion is focused on the US value premium and whether we can still count on it now that everyone knows that it exists. There is strong theoretical basis, whether we take the risk-based or behavioral position, to believe that a positive expected value premium will persist. Despite a run of relatively weak performance, we can't conclude with any confidence that the value premium has changed. And even this recent period of extreme pain falls well within what a value investor should expect from time to time. The recent weak performance of value may have even created an opportunity. I do not condone market timing or factor timing. They are both very hard to do successfully. Cliff Asness, the co-founder of AQR Capital and a former student of Eugene Fama, similarly discourages trying to time investment decisions, most of the time. Cliff has playfully referred to market and factor timing as sins, and suggests that investors only sin a little, and only in very specific cases. Cliff wrote a research note in late 2019 explaining that while factor timing is not usually a good idea, the current value spread makes a compelling case for sinning a little by increasing your weight in value stocks. The value spread is a tool that was created at AQR, and it is used to measure the relative cheapness of value stocks compared to history. Using AQR's measure for value, which includes controlling for things like profitability and earnings quality, as at August 2019, value was in the 97th percentile of historical cheapness. And excluding the tech bubble, it was as cheap as it has ever been by a fairly wide margin. Unlike Cliff, I am not saying that you should time a trade into value. But I do think that Cliff's point is applicable to anyone who already has a long-term value tilt in their portfolio. despite the recent pain, now might be the worst time to give up on value. I've spent a lot of this video telling you why we shouldn't give up on the US value premium, despite its relatively weak performance since it was publicized by Fama and French in 1992. We always have to remember that while the headlines tend to focus on the US is not the world. The experience of value investors in other countries over the same time period has been very different. From July 1991 through June 2019, the same post-publication period where we observed a declining US value premium, value stocks in Japan beat the Japanese market by an annualized 6.14%. Value stocks in the UK beat the UK market by a more modest 0.29% annualized. Emerging markets value beat the emerging markets by an annualized 3.02%. Asia-Pacific value beat the Asia-Pacific market by an annualized 5.4%. Australian value beat the Australian market by an annualized 2.95%. And in a strange twist, Canadian value trailed the Canadian market by an annualized 0.53%. Having a value tilt in a portfolio isn't for everyone. It can be painful, and it can be painful for long periods of time, as we've seen. For index investors, a value tilt also adds complexity through the need to add additional value index funds to a portfolio. For anyone willing to live through a bit of pain and manage a bit of extra complexity, we have seen that value stocks offer access to a meaningfully positive expected average premium. Recent history has been especially painful for value investors, but periods like this are where the premium is ultimately earned for those who stick with the strategy. Thanks for watching. My name is Ben Felix of PWL Capital, and this is Common Sense Investing. If you enjoyed this video, please share it with someone who you think could benefit from the information. And don't forget, if you've run out of Common Sense Investing videos to watch, you can tune in to weekly episodes of the Rational Reminder podcast, wherever you get your podcasts.